90.3 WHPC. Welcome to another edition of From the Press Box right here on 90.3 WHPC. My name is Rob Leonard. Joining me, of course, is my brother, award-winning sports writer Tim Leonard. And we are here every Monday, 9 a.m. to 10 a.m., talking sports. The show becomes a podcast later on Spreaker.com, iHeartRadio, and also, don't forget, Spotify. Anyway, brother, how are you doing? How you doing there?
I'm outstanding, brother. We should mention that your birthday was Sunday.
Yes, it was Sunday, the 20th.
Big one, brother.
Yeah,
big one.
Well, I turned 60. Also wish our friends Rob Tuck happy birthday for the 15th and Joe Whitman on August 12th. He also turned the big 6-0. But anyway, we always had that Leo thing going on, you know?
So, yes, but lots of Lions. The three Lions. You guys were like the England national team.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Anyway, Tim, we've reached a point in the baseball season where I think, I don't want to say all of New York because that's the wrong term, but many baseball fans in New York just don't care right now. We have the Mets doing horrible. We have the Yankees doing, I would say, worse, only because you expected more from them this year, though everyone expected a lot from the Mets also. I feel bad for the Yankees, because they're in that tough AL East. But at the same time, they are just falling apart in a different way than the Mets. And I don't know which team you want to start with first, the Mets or the Yankees.
I really don't care, brother.
Okay, let's.
It's look, this last week it was nice to see the Mets win a few games. They went 4-2 in six games, which, hey, great. They might have lost on Sunday, but at least that 4-2 for the Mets this season, that's a fine week. Meanwhile, the Yankees have lost now eight in a row after being swept by the Red Sox. They haven't lost that many games in a row since 1995, and the Yankees are now 60-64, firmly in last place in the American League East, and they're going nowhere, and it infuriates me, mostly because I said it for weeks before the trade deadline. You know, the Yankees need to sell. They need to get what they can. They need to try to unload some bad contracts and just, you know, kind of reboot. And instead, they did nothing. And right now, it's basically, you could say that they did nothing and it doesn't matter because they just stood pat. But when you stand pat, you're really moving backwards because other teams are improving. And the Yankees could have done things to improve their team for next season. And instead, they chose to hang on to this absolute delusional fantasy that they were going to somehow get hot and get into wild card position. And it's that dream is over. It's absolutely a 100% over. So they really did screw it up at the trade deadline. And I'll say it again, and I said it then, that if the Yankees didn't make any moves at the deadline, I wanted Brian Cashman fired. I have defended Brian Cashman for years, certainly since we've started doing this radio show, but I am now of the mindset that Brian Cashman needs to go.
Why is that, brother?
I don't understand how he could manage the trade deadline so badly and not recognize that this team is not going anywhere and needs a lot of help. And you look at some of the moves that they've made and some of the players that they've traded away to get one-dimensional players who just failed. And it's you start to say, all right, you know what? It's time to give somebody else a chance to do the job.
Well, Tim.
I don't and even Sunday, even yesterday, the Yankees wind up losing to the Red Sox, 7-6, 6-5, whatever it was. Ben Rorvet, the catcher, with the .098 batting average, is the Yankees' last gasp hope to get a hit with a man on second, with a tying run on second base. The guy's batting 098. Well, Aaron Boone's already used everybody else on his bench, so he can't pinch hit for the guy who's not even batting 100. Nice managing, Booney.
Well,
are you kidding? It's a joke. There's just so much going on that's bad.
Well, hold right Tim, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay,
yes,
just making sure you hear me, because first of all, I know you want to get rid of Brian Cashman now, but don't you think he is listening to direct orders from Hal Steinbrenner? First of all, I think that's
You don't think so? I don't. Because
I think Hal said, I leave the money alone.
Hal has told him, we've discussed this before, brother. Hal has told Cashman, under no circumstances are you to go over the luxury tax number. That number should be enough to win titles. And I don't necessarily disagree with that, because other teams certainly do it. And you don't need to spend like Steve Cohen to win a title, because look at what happened with the Mets this year. I mean, they're not even coming close to winning a title. So I don't necessarily disagree with that, but I think every other move in terms of the franchise, Brian Cashman is the decision maker. I mean, when he signed his last contract, that was very much part of the discussion, that Cashman was going to have more power and more decision-making authority. And it's not on Hal. I don't think Hal really cares. As long as the Yankees are making money, I don't think Hal really, he's not a baseball guy. He doesn't have that winning is more important than breathing thing, that gene that his father had. Hal is more, as long as the team is making money and we're competing and we make the playoffs, which obviously is not going to happen this season, then he's happy. But he is not a confrontational guy. He's not somebody who is going to look at this season and say, well, we need to fire some people, because he doesn't want to be that bad guy. And his father loved being that bad guy. His father wanted people to be scared of him because he thought that made them perform better at their jobs, which it didn't necessarily, but I'm sure probably for some people it did, but for a lot of people it did not. So they're really polar opposites in terms of personality, but here we are in a situation that kind of screams for Hal to be a little more like George and say, all right, it's time for new ideas and it's time for new sets of eyes and it's time for somebody else to actually do the jobs, because I think Aaron Boone has done a bad job this season. Part of that, though, has to do with a lot of injuries for the Yankees. But I just think Brian Cashman hasn't done a good enough job of putting a solid, healthy rotation together, and he really hasn't done a good job of putting a quality lineup around Aaron Judge. Aaron Judge is the only scary hitter the Yankees have right now. And I'm willing to give them a pass on Anthony Volpe, because you need to bring him up and get him accustomed to major league pitching. Because if you think that this kid is going to be your shortstop of the future, which obviously they think he is, then he needs to play at the major league level and he needs to get used to the major league level. Now, Volpe's hitting 215 or 220 or whatever it is, so it hasn't been a great rookie season. But you know what? He's going to finish the season with at least 20 home runs, which is good.
Right.
He's probably going to finish with somewhere in the neighborhood of 30-some stolen bases, also good. He's played good defense, but his batting average and his on-base percentage have been terrible. But besides those two guys, there's not a lot on this roster that I would say, yeah, I want this guy or that guy back next season. But you can't change an entire roster in one off season. So I'm kind of curious to see how that's going to go, which free agents the Yankees choose to bring back. Will they bring back Harrison Bader? I've been saying it for weeks. Will they figure out a way to unload Giancarlo Stanton? You know, what's going to be the story with Frankie Montas? Do you sink more money into this kid? He's going to be a free agent after the season, but do you sink money into him because you made the trade for him and you gave up three or four prospects to Oakland to bring him in and he barely pitched? So, you know, those decisions are what will make the Yankees either contenders or just another team next season.
Well, let's not get ahead of ourselves talking about next season yet. We're still in the end of August, so I don't want to get too far ahead of that. We should say that the Yankees right now are 60-64. They are in last place in the AL East. Until maybe last week or the week before, they were over 500. So they are, they're going down the hill instead of up the hill.
Right, but that's what losing eight games in a row. That's what
right,
it does to you,
buddy. Right, well, yeah, so... So anyway, one thing that, is happening, Yankee fans can look forward to this, though they're having it in September, which they've never had a September All-Timers game, but September 9th, they will be celebrating the 25th anniversary of the 1998 Yankees. The Core Four will be there, brother.
Yes, Derek Jeter making his first All-Timers Day appearance.
And there will be some whispers, brother, that Derek Jeter being there, they might say he might be ready to be the Yankees general manager. And I know that's speculation. I don't want to get too much into it, but that's going to be the talk for the next maybe couple of weeks that happens. So
you are correct about that, brother. Now, that being said, I would not be happy if Derek Jeter was named the Yankees general manager. I don't think he has the chops for the job.
Well,
I'll tell you who I would like to make the Yankees GM is Kim Ng, who was once Brian Cashman's assistant, who is now doing very good things with the Florida Marlins, and has been able to put together a contending club. They've actually faded recently, but she's put together a contending club on a very limited payroll. So good for her, but Derek Jeter is no longer involved with the Marlins. So I mean, he was the face of the club, but I don't know that he was the one who was actually making the trades and pulling the triggers and whatnot. So I think this talk about making Jeter the GM is a lot of nonsense.
Yeah, no, I agree. I think, maybe he should wait a little longer or do something else to get a little more experience or something. We should say that Bernie Williams has not yet committed to attending this All-Timers game on September 9th. So it's going to be a big, big, big cheering day for Yankee fans because they haven't had much this year, which is unfortunate.
It might be the last day to look forward to it on the home schedule this season.
Yep.
And it's certainly going to be the last feel-good day of this season.
Definitely, definitely. Now, the Mets. Let's talk about the Mets, brother. They still stink. They are 58-67. They are 9 games under 500. Though they're 6-2 in their last 8 games, brother. So that means they're doing better, isn't it?
Yes, it does. Yeah, you know what? I said 4-2 before. Yeah, 6-2 in the last 8. That's my bad. Good catch, brother. But yeah, 6-2 in the last 8. I mean, how do you say anything negative about that? Good for the Mets. They're finally playing some decent ball. It helped that they played against a Cardinals team that's been terrible all season. But who cares? The Mets need some wins. I'm sure Mets fans are going all crazy. Oh, we shouldn't have traded Verlander. We should have traded Robertson. We should have traded Scherzer. Now look at us. We're winning games. You're still not catching the Marlins. You're still not catching anybody you need to catch to be a wild card team. Even though the National League could quite possibly not live up to what we've started to call on the show the Tim Leonard rule, which is to be a wild card team, you need to be in the neighborhood of 10 games over 500. Because right now, the wild card in the National League is, it's being decided by teams that are barely over 500. The Giants as of today are 6 games over 500 and they have the number 2 wild card spot. And the Cubs are five games over, and they have the last spot. So they're only five games over. It's not that much. And there's three teams that are three games over 500 and obviously are very much in the hunt because they're only a half a game or a game behind these teams. So there are five legitimate teams in the National League wild card, none of whom are 10 games over, and they might all struggle to get to 10 games over. But, you know, that's where things are in the National League right now. The very good teams, such as the Atlanta Braves, and to a lesser extent, the Los Angeles Dodgers, but there's a lot of just pretty good teams in the National League. So, I don't know that any of them will get hot or do anything before the playoffs or in the playoffs. I still think we're going to see the Dodgers and the Braves in the National League Championship Series. But, you know, for playoff positioning and who makes it and who doesn't, it's going to – right now it's looking like it's going to turn into a battle. So we'll see where that goes.
Yeah, and one thing, I'm looking at the stats right now for the Mets. No one is hitting really well at all. Average wise, I mean, Lindor's hitting .252.
Yeah, but that's up for him, bro.
Yeah, I know.
Remember,
it's up for
.230 something.
Right, and
he's hitting better. He really has done well in the second half.
Yes, he has. McNeil is doing .263, .268 for Brandon Nimmo. Pete Alonso, while he has 39 home runs, which is impressive, is batting .224. So, and most, yes, no one else is batting over basically .250.
It's in that range, but that's, yeah, you know, that's pretty much still baseball, brother. I mean, it's, you're not going to have too many 300 hitters.
Yeah, but there's not even like a .280. You know, that's a major difference. And as much as I love Pete Alonso, you know, I would trade away 15 of those homers if he was batting .260. So,
well, I mean, he still has a lot of RBIs, so he's still getting it done in the situations where he needs to get it done. But I agree, because his on-base percentage isn't very good. You know, I mean, there are certainly things that he could be doing better, but he's not. So, you know, I mean, that's just it's kind of a microcosm of the Mets season is to me how Alonso has played and how McNeil has played, because McNeil won a batting title last year, and now he's hitting .260 or .250 or whatever he's hitting. You don't drop off 50 or 60 points from your batting average and, you know, think you've had anything remotely close to a successful season. I'm sure when the Mets signed him to that long-term contract, they were expecting a 300 hitter. He hasn't been that guy. He's been very average this season.
He's been less than average, brother. I mean, I don't know. I expect, if you get all this money, I expect just a little more. You know, I bet you Lindor hits .275 by the end of the season.
He might. There's still 6 weeks left in the season. It's certainly possible that he could raise his average that much. He's hit well. I mean, it's no other, you know, there's as much as we were ripping the guy early in the season when he was batting .225 or .230, you know, he certainly has been doing a better job. Here, I'm looking at stats right now, brother, on my rotisserie baseball side. I know you hate rotisserie. But in just for example, in the last 21 days, Francisco Lindor is batting .371.
That's very good.
Two home runs and 11 RBIs in 18 games, which, you know, maybe the power numbers could be a little bit better. But .371, his on-base percentage is .436. I mean, his slugging percentage is .543. Those are all all-star numbers. So Francisco Lindor is finally playing like a 30-something million-dollar-a-year player should be playing, but it took him 3-4 months to get there. So, you know, I mean, it's part of what has ailed the Mets all season. And it's great that Lindor has bounced back and is putting up numbers now, but the fact of the matter is that it's easy to play when there's nothing to play for. You know, nobody is looking at the Mets as any kind of a threat because they are no longer a threat.
No, you're right about that. Yeah. No.
So, you know, it's too bad, but the Mets at least recognized what they are or what they were or what they, you know, what this season has held for them. And they finally, then they said at the deadline, it's all right, you know what? We're going to unload it, and we're going to pay what we need to pay to get rid of guys and pay what we need to do to get real prospects back and not just dump salaries. So I give the Mets all the credit in the world for doing what they did and how they did it, because that's what needed to be done. And they said, all right, we're not good. We're not going to make the playoffs. We're not going to pretend like we're better than we are, or that we're going to rip off a 12-game winning streak and magically get back into things, because that's not going to happen. It's not reality. So let's go get some players and plan for the future and get rid of some of these contracts and fine, whatever, you know, like if it costs money, then fine, it costs money, but let's get better.
Like I said, I'm not sure.
The Mets made themselves a better future.
They did. I'm just not sure it's going to matter with Atlanta being Atlanta for the next 5 years. So, you know, that's going to be the thing to look at. But if you get wild card the next 5 years, then okay, I'll take that, because it's all the playoffs. And but get this, the next few games, it's Atlanta 3 games, Los Angeles 3 games. Wow.
Yeah.
So.
And it's probably going to hurt. It's, you know, don't be surprised if – if, you know, and I don't know, are those games at home or on the road?
At Atlanta and versus at home against Los Angeles. So,
all right, at Atlanta, you probably lose 2 out of 3, and home against the and you know, it's probably going to be 2-4. I mean, if it's anything better than 2-4, then great. If it's 3-3, I'd be happy. I'd be really happy if I was a Mets fan. And if somehow they go 4-2 in those 6 games, that would be a miracle.
I agree. So,
but you know, I mean, I heard something. I was actually watching some of the Met game on yesterday, on Sunday, and they were talking about around the deadline and what the Mets needed to do, and how the back of the rotation was going to be key for them to maybe be a wild card contender, and that's the problem. Is Jose Quintana has been terrible this season. Kodai Senga has been really the only guy on that staff who probably exceeded expectations. Carlos Carrasco has been a disaster. So, you know, you're not going to win games when one of your aces isn't pitching like an ace. Your other ace misses the first month, but then pitches pretty well. Senga pitched well most of the time, but then, you know, Quintana barely pitched for the first, what, 2 or 3 months, and then he just got his first win last week. And Carrasco's been a disaster. So, and this is what I keep preaching with the Yankees as well. You need starting pitching, and you need it. It has to be not only good, but it has to be healthy. So, like, for me, the Yankees, Nestor Cortez is a very good pitcher. He's turned himself into a very good pitcher. This year, he has not been healthy almost at all. So I like that he's on the team, and I like the pitcher he is, but if he's not healthy, then he's not doing anybody any good. And I hate to take such a, you know, such a business-like approach to it, but that's just how it is. Because if Nestor can't pitch, that means now you're either getting somebody else to you know, either acquiring somebody else, or now having a minor leaguer take those starts. And typically when it's a minor leaguer taking those starts, they don't do very well.
Yeah. Well, one
and
thing
that's been how it is with the Mets. David Peterson's been terrible this year too.
Well, one thing we can say is, as Met fans, well, you're a Yankee fan, but that the Mets are in fourth place and the Yankees are in last place. So,
well, you know, but the Mets are still 9 games under .500.
I know, that's the difference. That's the difference. But the Yankees, like, you know, they're 4 games under .500, so
yeah, I'm certainly not making any excuse for the Yankees. They especially in the last few weeks, there have been people making the case, and I don't necessarily disagree that you look at this Yankee team. I mean, first of all, the lineup is awful, but secondly, I'm looking at a team that looks like it's given up. And Aaron Boone can talk after the game all he wants about how they got to play better and they got to win some games, but I don't see the effort. I don't see you know, quality players who are playing like they care, because it doesn't look like they do. 8-game losing streaks don't happen by accident.
No, they don't.
And other teams know that all they have to do is walk Judge, and there's nobody else in that lineup that's going to beat them.
No, it's almost like he's an island in the sea right now. You know, he's just, no one else is around him to protect him, or, you know, they just bat around him, or pitch around him, I should say.
Yeah, so. There's games where it seems like, to me, there's been a couple of games where it seems like Judge is just determined not to walk. But there was a game a few days ago, where he struck out three times. Right. To me, that was Aaron Judge saying, all right, I'm not letting him walk me. I'm swinging a bat, and if I strike out, then the hell with it. But I'm not going to just take four balls and walk to first base. I'm going to at least take some swings and see if I can hit a home run or do something. But that, if he does that, then he gets into bad habits. And if he gets into bad habits, then there's nobody on the team that can do anything about it.
No. Good news for the Yankees. They're playing the Nationals starting on tomorrow. But then they play Tampa Bay and then Detroit.
Tampa Bay has been bad in the second half, brother.
Yeah, but they're still ahead.
I'm not worried about Tampa Bay so much.
They're still ahead, though.
Hopefully one of the Yankees pitchers will drill one of those guys.
Hey, Tampa Bay is only two games behind the Orioles, so.
What did Paul Newman say? What do they call them? Gutless punks?
Yeah, something like that, yeah.
Yeah, that's Tampa Bay.
Yeah, well, you know, right now they're only two games behind being in first, so.
Yankees need a killer Carlson to go after one of those Tampa Bay guys.
Yeah. So, it's been very quiet. You know, I was thinking maybe we should go to a Ducks game because I haven't seen a Ducks game in a while, and I don't even know how they're doing. So, I'll look them up in a second.
I mean, brother, we should have gone to the Cyclones yesterday. They had the Seinfeld bobblehead doll thing.
Oh, they did?
Yeah, George Costanza was riding a whale. Would have been an awesome bobblehead. Buscema would have made me go to that game.
I didn't even know about it, you know. And, of course, the Ferry Hawks, you know, I haven't been over to Staten Island to see them. So the
that's a journey to get over there, brother.
Nah, you take the train down to the ferry, and then you just go to the terminal. It's right there.
Bit of a walk, brother.
A little bit, but, you know.
Bit of a walk.
Yeah.
Well, let me know. If you want to do it, I'll do it. Let me know.
I'm thinking about it. It'd be nice just to, you know, sit back and not care. You know, part of going to a minor league game is, you know, it's a day out. You know, you hopefully things are cheaper in the ballpark and maybe catch a baseball, you know, which it's tougher to do now at the major league parks. They have all the fencing.
Yeah, but
around.
They make you give it to the kid if you catch one in a minor league stadium.
They do, not me.
Well, I mean, hey, you can always protest it.
Well, I'm just looking at the Ducks right now. They're 16-20. Staten Island Ferry Hawks are 21-17.
There you go.
That's not nice. Ducks are in last place too.
is that Wally Backman's team?
Yeah.
Wally.
You know, maybe we should have him on, at least to someone to talk about the 86 Mets and something positive. So okay, well that, you know, it's so we have two teams out of the four in New York area who are in last place. And the Mets are in fourth place and the Ferry Hawks are in third place, but only by a couple of games. So They're playing
similar.
We need
to get somebody up to second place, brother.
Yeah.
By the way, don't forget, brother, your boy Bartolo will be feted by the Mets on Saturday.
Are you sure it's this Saturday? I thought it was a couple of weeks.
I thought it was the 26th, isn't it?
I don't know. Well, that's right. It would be this week.
It was the 26th. I don't know. I'll double check.
You're right. You're right, brother.
I'm fairly certain I am correct on this.
We love Bartolo. Yeah. And how does a team sell tickets? How do the Mets sell tickets when, you know, the season's over? You know, and I feel bad for the season ticket holders, because the way they sell the season ticket holders to them, it says, well, if you can't go to the games, you can just sell them online. But if the team's doing horrible, you can't give the ticket away. You know, and the Mets are doing bad.
That's the issue. And that's what I want to see. I want to see if, because I'll put this out there in public, brother. I donated blood before the season, and I'm supposed to get two free tickets to a Mets game. But it says that I have to use the tickets, or I have to use the voucher between Monday and Thursday.
Oh,
now,
okay.
Obviously, this game is on a Saturday, I'm hoping that the Mets recognize the fact that they're lucky I want to even come to a game.
Yeah.
And say, all right, you know, Saturday, don't worry about it. Yeah, just use it whenever you want to use it.
Okay, so brother, here's my confusion. September 17th, which is a Sunday, they're giving away a Bartolo Colon T-shirt. Long sleeve T-shirt. So that's what they're doing. But they're not giving it away the day he retires as a Met. So,
well, let's face it, brother. That T-shirt that they're going to give away, first of all, it's going to be poorly made. Secondly, I doubt it will be any bigger than an extra large.
Well, I'm looking at it right now. First 15,000 fans. So
first 15,000. So yeah, that means getting to the ballpark early to get a shirt that's not going to fit.
Yeah, I don't think they have my size.
Well, that's kind of where I'm going with that, bro. I'm trying to be nice.
Everything's the first 15,000 fans, you know.
Yeah, I mean, let's hope 15,000 show up.
Yeah, well, that's the thing now. You know, where do you go with that? But that's not really fair. I mean, you know, 15,000, you know, there's a 45,000 seat of a place, you know. But anyway.
Well, they're like I said, the 26th, they're going to honor him.
Right.
They're having the day, that day on the 17th. Because that's I think that's the day he is planned to officially retire from, or actually no, I think he retired in June actually. Yeah, he did in June.
Yeah.
So I don't know why there's two dates.
I don't either. I don't either.
You know, I mean,
well, they're not. We should say they're not retiring his number. We should say
no,
that.
Of course not. Why would they?
I don't know. I wouldn't. I mean, you know, I was reading about. I was reading an article. I forgot which paper it was in, and it was talking about how Greg Nettles, you know, should be included as part of the, you know, Monument Park area, and you know, he was there for a long time. I mean,
not that long. I mean, he had a, don't get me wrong. Greg Nettles was a great player for a few years for the Yankees. He certainly won the 1978 World Series single handedly,
right,
with his play at third base.
But you know, the thing about it is, brother, his number's already retired. You know,
well, yeah, that's number nine.
So to put his name, you know, to have like a circle of fame, like more of the football teams have, to put his name there, the number's already retired. Roger Maris's number is number nine. So it wouldn't hurt to do it, you know? You know, unless the Yankees are still angry with him for, you know, writing the great book he wrote. So,
well, I don't know that is necessarily the case, but. You know, I mean, but like you said, Roger Maris has number nine retired. Do you throw Greg Nettles? Do you attach him to that?
Yeah, because
20,
they
20 something years after the fact.
Well, I mean, that's something else. Look what they did with number eight. It's Bill Dickey and Yogi Berra. So
yeah, but Bill Dickey was Yogi Berra's mentor. So I mean, that's why Yogi took number eight, and then late, you know, much later in Yankees history, they decided to retire it, and they said, all right, you know what, we'll just do it for both of them.
Right, and they could also do it for Bobby Mercer, too, because he wore number one and number two at different times, and to attach it to that, you know, did he have a great, you know, baseball career as a Yankee? It's a couple of seasons, but he was an announcer, too, so he's there also with that, so.
Well, if they did that, they'll attach it to number one with Billy Martin, because they're not going to attach him to Derek Jeter.
No, because I'm sure
Derek Jeter deserves to have number two by himself.
Well, I agree with that. And also, I believe it's contractual things that, you know, if you buy a number two jersey with the, you know, a Yankee jersey number two, everyone, since the number's retired and it's attached to Derek Jeter, he gets a payment out of it, I believe, or some sort of.
Probably.
Some sort of thing like that. Anyway, we're going to take a break right now. You're listening to From the Press Box right here on 90.3 WHPC. We are streaming at nccradio.org.
This show on 90.3 WHPC is brought to you by United Auto Body, located at 275 East Merrick Road in Valley Stream. United Auto Body specializes in auto body repairs and insurance claims adjustments. Professional tow truck services are also available. Open 6 days a week, closed Sundays. More information is available at 516-825-1330. That's 516-825-1330. Or online at UnitedAutoBodyInc.com.
This show on 90.3 WHPC is brought to you by the Fall Open House at Nassau Community College on Sunday, October 29th at 9:30 a.m. at the Physical Education Complex. Interested in studying at Nassau? Are you the parent or grandparent of a high school student trying to decide which college they will attend? The Fall Open House at Nassau Community College on Sunday, October 29th is where students can apply for admission, learn about academic and student services, hear from the faculty representing over 80 majors, get a sense of life on campus from our students, and chat with admissions and financial aid counselors. More information about the Fall Open House at Nassau Community College on Sunday, October 29th can be found online at ncc.edu/openhouse.
Okay. Yo.
Tell your friends about the Nassau Morning Madhouse. Hear what you're missing.
Check it out.
Check it out.
We're talking about things that made us say, you know what, screw it, I'm done, I'm putting this down, I'm walking away.
I was heading out for a date to the mall, and I was just waiting for this girl, basically. She made me wait for like at least 5 hours until...
What?
You know what?
You waited for 5 hours?
No girl is like, worth 5 hours.
I was like, hell to the no. You know what? She ain't even worth it.
Because you waited 5 hours already!
The most she would have given you was 15 seconds, dog.
What at the 5 hour mark was like, you know what, I'm done.
That's
like,
it.
Why?
Not 4.5 hours.
5 hours.
Yeah.
I think it was, I came in like around like 3, like 3 p.m. all the way to
the mall was closing.
The
that's
mall
why.
Was closing.
Yeah, the mall was
and
closing.
You were still, maybe she'll still come.
The Nassau Morning Madhouse. Weekday mornings from 7 to 9.
Yeah.
On the voice of Nassau Community College,
90.3 WHPC.
We're back here on From the Press Box on 90.3 WHPC. And my name is Rob Leonard, and he is Tim Leonard, and we talk sports every Monday. And we're going to do the weather right now, brother, just so people can know what the weather is like. Your WHPC weather forecast, powered by Pantanos, with locations in Hewlett, Uniondale, Garden City Park, Freeport, and now open in Levittown. This afternoon, it's going to be mostly cloudy, high about 88. Wow, getting up there. I thought the summer weather was over, but we guess it has come back. Tonight will be still cloudy, low about 72. And tomorrow, we're going to have mostly cloudy skies, high about 72. Currently outside the studios at Nassau Community College, it is, it's about 76 degrees. Anyway, brother, we've talked about the Yankees. We've talked about the Mets. Let's talk about the team I think is going to be the big story this fall, and that is the New York Jets. So, what do you think?
Quite possible, brother.
I agree. I think Aaron Rodgers hasn't played one down yet in the exhibition season or game. You can't even call it a season. Why do they even have exhibition games? But anyway, he hasn't played it down, but so reportedly against the Giants this Saturday, he will be at least calling some plays, and probably the starting lineup will be in that game also, huh?
Well, yeah, the Jets, from what we're hearing and what's being said, will play most of their starters for at least one series. I assume that it will only be one series against the Giants at MetLife Stadium. And coincidentally, the Giants probably won't play any of their starters in that game because Daniel Jones played in the previous game against Carolina and actually did very well. But Aaron Rodgers hasn't played an exhibition game since 2018. But, you know, I mean, he has to play at least something. He needs to get into a situation where they are playing against a different team in a controlled environment, which is an exhibition game, so that the Jets can kind of make some evaluations as far as where they are and what they need and what they have to do and what needs to improve, et cetera, et cetera. But for now, the only way they're going to do that is for Aaron Judge to take some snaps in a preseason game. And since he hasn't done that yet, since all he's done
it's Aaron Rodgers, brother. You said Aaron Judge there.
Oh, my bad. Well, Aaron Judge would probably be better, probably wants to play quarterback anyway. But Aaron Rodgers needs to take some snaps. He needs to, you know, he needs at least one series. And it wouldn't surprise, well, actually, it probably would surprise me. I think he'll just play one series. But if that series does not go well, it wouldn't necessarily surprise me to see him play another series. But that being said, if it doesn't go well because the opposing defense is chasing him around the field, then no, he won't play another series. But it wouldn't surprise me that if things go fairly well, that maybe Aaron Rodgers says to Saleh, yeah, hey, yeah, I'll do another series. Let's see what we can do. Let's go have some fun. Now, that being said, brother, there is some history in place here. With the Giants and Jets in exhibition games, because if you recall, and I'm sure you will, brother, because you do recall very well, there was in 2013, Mark Sanchez was playing in the fourth quarter against the Giants in the preseason when he suffered a season-ending shoulder injury.
Yes, everyone was saying, why was he in the fourth?
Exactly. Why is Mark Sanchez in an exhibition game in the fourth quarter, you know, when somebody who will be, you know, unloading a truck the week after should be playing in the fourth quarter of an exhibition game? And also in 2003, Chad Pennington broke his left hand and missed the first six regular season games in an exhibition game against the Giants. Now, those tend to notice that, bro. 2003, 2013. This is 2023. So years ending in three have not been good to the Jets with the Giants at quarterback. So, you know, let's hope that karma it does no longer exists, because that certainly would be the absolute worst thing that could happen to the Jets season, is Aaron Rodgers getting hurt in this exhibition game.
Well, I'm looking at a picture of him right now, and what's with the mustache, man? You know, it's...
Oh, Rodgers?
Yeah, I'm looking at a picture right now.
He's had that the whole preseason.
Really? I haven't really noticed that.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm not sure.
It's his way of showing that he's going gray.
Oh, okay, is that it? Okay.
Yeah.
But, you know, I hope he... You know, I know a lot of Jet fans who are happy right now, even though he hasn't played one bit in a game. The Jet fans are happy. I haven't seen them, you know, making reservations to be on the top of the building, ready to jump. So I'm very happy. They're at the edge of a building. You know, they jump off the edge of the windowsill, and you know how Jet
not
fans
this
get.
Year.
Not this year, but that's what I was saying. You know, they're not ready to jump off the building, and it's
they have optimism, bro. There's reason for optimism for Jet fans this year. So let's not talk about buildings or anything else.
Well, I'm just saying, you know, I haven't heard, you know, all the Jet fans that I know are very upbeat,
as they should be. You know? The only thing the Jets need to figure out is their offensive line. If they can get that figured out or acquire a couple of bodies that can actually block people, then the Jets have as good a chance as anybody. You know, maybe not Kansas City, maybe not Cincinnati or Buffalo, but the Jets will be in the mix. And that's all the Jet fans want. It's been a long time since the Jets have just been, you know, talked about as a contender. And right now, that's how they're being talked about. And you know, the fact that they're on Hard Knocks makes them even more noticeable, I guess. Saleh is talking a lot about, you know, hey, this is, you know, we don't want to be the same old Jets, and we want to, you know, achieve what we can achieve. But, you know, the fact of the matter is that the Jets just brought in Dalvin Cook. They finally officially signed him last week on Wednesday, and actually Cook wound up going right to Florida because his first child was being born. So he's going to be joining the team this week for practice. But it's, you know, and I've said it more than a couple of times this season. If they don't address the offensive line issues, skilled players can't skill if there's nobody blocking or if the blocking is terrible. And right now, the Jets blocking isn't very good. So if they can get that part of it sorted out, then yeah, the Jets will be a very good team. The defense, they have a very good defense. there's a lot of nasty on that defense, and they're waiting to show other teams how nasty they can be. And that's a Robert Saleh thing. He loves a nasty defense, but you know, the offense has to be able to score enough points.
Right. And
Aaron Rodgers is supposed to be that guy. And, you know, Garrett Wilson and Alan Lazard and a lot of receivers and Dalvin Cook and Breece Hall. And there's plenty of skill guys there, but you need to be able to block. So that's my only thing that I'm crossing my fingers and hoping against hope for, is that the Jets can figure out the offensive line and figure out how to protect Aaron Rodgers.
Yeah, no, that's the main goal this year for the Jets. I'd like to actually go to a game, but I'm on the website to look for tickets, and it's the Jets website. It's not like a resale site. $185 for upper level seats, my brother.
That's crazy.
That's crazy. And that doesn't include the fees.
Do the old trick, brother. The old trick is StubHub.
Yeah, I know, but the team
couple
has to
hours
be...
before the game. Just get on StubHub.
Yeah,
and find a pair, and then we'll just hop on a train.
I mean, $185 is a lot for one ticket.
That's nuts.
You know,
Absolutely.
I at least get a beer with it or something? I mean,
you don't even get that.
And then they wonder why people aren't buying tickets. That it used to be a sellout. I mean, not a sellout. It used to be a season ticket thing. You couldn't get on the Jets list, especially the Giants list.
That's got to be some kind of reseller. That can't be the Jets.
It says the Jets.
It's got to be a season ticket holder reselling or something.
Maybe, I don't know.
That is going through the website and then the Jets get a piece of it or something. But because the Jets, I mean, the season tickets for the Jets are probably for that level of seats, probably $75.
Really? Well, it says
it shouldn't be much more than that.
Okay, well,
maybe 80 at this point. I don't know, but I mean, I would have to look, but it's certainly not $185.
I will check because it says the Jets site and it says Ticketmaster, so it doesn't say like StubHub or anything. Well, maybe I'm wrong, but I would be surprised.
Well, that's how I got tickets for Springsteen many years ago.
Right.
Got on StubHub. It was about an hour before the show. I was living in Jersey at the time, not too far from MetLife Stadium. Found a great seat in the private box area for like $35 or $40. Jumped on it. Thank you very much. Had a nice, comfortable seat. Had a place where it was very easy to get the food and beverage because there was a limited number of people that could be in there. So the lines were short. You could just go right to the concessions, boom, get a beer and something to eat, and you're back in a seat, and you know, it's still between songs.
Right. Well, that's good.
So
that's good. Well, anyway, so I look forward to the Jets season. The Giants, Daniel Jones has been playing decent in the exhibition games.
Well, he just had that one game.
But still,
he was very good. He was very good against Carolina.
Right. That's what you want to see some growth in. You know, I feel bad for is Zach Wilson because I think he's been playing pretty decent.
Why?
In the exhibition. He's like sort of, he's going to be the backup guy. We know that. But he's had, I guess with the pressure off him, he's a little bit better than maybe.
Feel good for Zach Wilson, brother, because you know why? Because with
he'll be wearing the baseball hat all year.
With Aaron Rodgers' help, first of all, Zach Wilson won't get killed this season. But with Aaron Rodgers' help, Zach Wilson might have just reclaimed his career. And I say might because we don't know if Zach Wilson will actually be a good quarterback, and we probably won't find out for another couple of years. But for him right now, Aaron Rodgers showing up was probably the best thing for him because he was about to wash out of the league.
Oh yeah, yeah, he would have if they didn't get Aaron Rodgers this year, he maybe starts, but he most likely if he played like last year, he'd be gone.
Well, yeah, either gone or I don't know if the Jets would have looked actively for another quarterback, but I doubt that Zach Wilson would have been allowed to start for the Jets this season after the season he had last year.
Oh yeah, yeah. Yeah.
So that was the best thing that could have happened for Zach Wilson is that the Jets not only got a starting quarterback, but they got a guy who could mentor Zach Wilson and say, look, this is how you play quarterback in the NFL. And if you have the talent, and we think you have the talent, But if you actually do have the talent, then in a couple of years' time, we'll turn the team back over to you, and you can do your thing now with all this knowledge, and reps and non-pressure that these 2 years are going to afford him.
No, I agree. So good for him, and yeah, I feel bad for these guys who come in with a lot of hope, and then and there's been a lot of quarterbacks with the Jets who come in with hope, and it doesn't end up the way you'd want it to be. So, I always feel a little bad for them. New York's a tough town. When you do good, they embrace you, and you're set for life. If you have like Sanchez. I thought Sanchez was okay for a little while, and he faded away, so to speak. So
quickly.
Yep.
Quickly.
Yep.
I mean, brother, it comes down to if you have talent. If you have talent, you'll be loved in this town. But if you don't, or if your GM and coaching staff don't put enough talent around you, then you look at the quarterbacks who have been in New York, and it's been rare that the Jets have drafted a quarterback and developed him. I mean, Chad Pennington was kind of that guy for a little while, but look at the quarterbacks who have had success here. And it's been a lot of retread. Vinny Testaverde had success, but Vinny was not a lifelong Jet. He was He was a guy they picked up who they got lucky with.
Yeah, then he hurt his toe on the Meadowlands carpet. By the way, right. I'm looking at another game here, brother. I'm looking at the Los Angeles Chargers, and their tickets are listed here on Ticketmaster, starting with $74. So
there you go. That's what I'm talking about.
I wonder if it's different games have different prices like.
Of course they do.
Yeah, that's not good.
That's what I'm talking about. It's resellers, brother.
But I don't think this doesn't look like it says ticket. It doesn't say reseller, but maybe it is. It says ticket exchange.
They're not going to tell you that.
They're
not going to tell you that they're double dipping and making twice the profit on the same ticket.
Yeah. Well, maybe you're right. You have to wait till closer to game time, or do something along those lines, or maybe you get a package where you go and get like one of those party buses or something.
Trust me, bro. I learned this from my longtime friend Marianne Mustachio. She's an expert at this.
I'm sure.
Not just for football tickets, but mostly for concert tickets. But
yes,
it applies to football as well.
Okay, let's quickly. We got about 6 minutes, brother. Let's talk about the Women's World Cup. Spain has become, they're the winners of the Women's World Cup. Tell us about this. They beat England. Do they actually call themselves England, not Great Britain?
Yes.
1-0. So congratulations to Spain.
Yeah, because Great Britain, I think, encompasses like other parts of the United Kingdom. I'm not even sure, but yeah, they go by England, brother, because it's England. It's just England. It's not Wales, no Ireland, no Northern Ireland, no anything. But yeah, the Spanish ladies, they got a goal in the first half from Olga Carmona, who actually was also the hero of the semifinal match, because she scored the goal very late in that match. It was a frenzied finish after going 0-0 for the majority of the game. Three goals were scored in the last 8 minutes, and Olga Carmona got the last one with like a few seconds left to send Spain past Sweden 2-1 in the semifinals and get them to the final. And then she scored in the 29th minute of the final, I guess we'll call it very early Sunday morning, and then Spain's defense held. There was a curious decision for me in that match. Lauren Rees, who had been England's best player, as far as I'm concerned, throughout the tournament, she got suspended 2 games because she basically stepped on a player in the Nigeria match, which England won, and was red carded. So they wound up deciding their suspension would be 2 games for that red card, which meant that she did not play in the quarterfinals or the semifinals. But then when you have somebody who has scored goals and been a great player for you in the tournament, the England coach did not start her. And she put her in the second half, and England was already down 1-0. I don't understand that decision. I don't understand why you wouldn't start your best player. And maybe it was some sort of a disciplinary thing for the stupidity of the red card and for stepping on a player intentionally, which really is stupid. But, you know, you're playing for the world championship. I don't understand why she was on the bench for 45 minutes when she showed how important she was to this team in the earlier parts of the tournament.
Right, right. The other
part that was actually the tragedy of this is that Olga Carmona found out after the game, you just win the World Cup and you're thrilled and, you know, like this is the greatest moment of your life. But she's told after the game that her father passed away.
Wow.
It's like, how do you deal with that kind of emotion? You go from this ultimate high, this greatest moment of your life to, oh yeah, by the way, your father died earlier.
Well, it's one of those things where, you know, you're not going to tell that person until after the game.
Exactly. I'm sure she would have agreed with it. I'm sure her father would have agreed with it. You know, don't tell her until the game is over because you want her to be able to function at peak efficiency and to get something that she's probably dreamed about her entire life. But you know, what just a remarkable range of emotions that she must have experienced. And you know, like, great for her that she won, but what a tragic end of the day for her.
Right, and I want to talk about also, didn't the U.S. women's national team get rid of their coach?
Yes, Vladko Andonovski actually resigned, which kind of was surprised because they did it while the World Cup was still going on, but definitely the right decision. He should have resigned. He was terrible as the manager, and I hope that whoever the United States Soccer Federation hires is somebody who will adopt a more free-flowing offensive style that the United States is known for and is excellent at playing, rather than the style that we were playing in this World Cup, which is more defensive and goes against every fiber of a U.S. women's soccer team performance. So, you know, but changes need to be made. And whoever the new coach is does have their work cut out for them, because it's not going to be just putting a new coach in and saying, all right, yeah, now everything's good. Now we're back to being the best team in the world, because there's a lot of work to do.
Right, right. So I'm glad he resigned. Whether he was asked to and then he said, well, I'll resign, or maybe they gave him the opportunity. I don't know, but I thought he did a horrible coaching job too. You're supposedly the best team in the world, and you didn't play very well, I thought.
Correct, brother. Absolutely correct.
So, anyway, brother, I got to read.
He was definitely pushed out the door. So.
Yeah, I got to read this before we leave. Play It Cool every Thursday at 9 p.m., an hour dedicated to the latest and greatest hip-hop and R&B music. Most recent and popular records will be played and showcased on this timeless show we call Play It Cool every Thursday at 9 p.m. right here at 90.3 WHPC. My name is Rob Leonard. Thank you for listening to From the Press Box. Anything else? You got 30 seconds, brother. You have anything else to say, or are you done?
Tottenham 2, Manchester United 0. First win for Big Ange in the new Tottenham era.
And no Harry Kane. Anyway.
Don't need him.
2-0. Anyway, thank you for listening. Coming up next at 10 o'clock is Big Ed with the Good Gold Show. My name is Rob Leonard. He's Tim Leonard. Thank you for listening. Take care and bye. Bye. Okay, brother.
What was that bye-bye, brother?
I had to hit the right button and I wasn't ready. So.
Yes, brother.
So, anyway, that just about does it.
Is that a wrap?
That's a wrap.
All right. Very good, brother.
Good stuff.